We are taking chapter number 4, which is motion in a plane. Question answer on motion in a plane. State for each of the following physical quantities if it is scalar or vector. All these quantities are there. Let me tell you first the scalar and vector. Scalar means only the magnitude, or you can say quantity, any value. Vector has value also, some magnitude also, along with the direction. In these, volume, mass, speed, density, number of moles, and angular frequency, these are scalar quantities. Acceleration, velocity, displacement, angular velocity, these are vectors. In fact, displacement is computed with direction, then velocity is computed from displacement, that is why it is also a vector. Acceleration is computed from velocity, so it is also a vector. Pick out the two scalar quantities in the following list: force, angular momentum, work, current, linear momentum, electric field, average velocity, magnetic moment, and relative velocity. Work and current, these are the two scalar quantities. How is work being defined? So work is simply the force into displacement. Force is what? Mass into acceleration into displacement. So acceleration and displacement, how can you say that when you say you are multiplying these, then it has to be vector because we have force. But in fact, this is not a cross, but this is a dot product. So whenever you have a dot product, the force and displacement, when they are, you know, product using, or their product is computed using a dot, then these two quantities, or the result of the dot product, is a scalar quantity. Okay, so dot product of two quantities is always a scalar quantity. That is why work, it is seen like it is a vector quantity, but it is in fact a scalar quantity. How about current? Current is only described by the magnitude, not the direction. So direction of a current is not taken into account. Therefore, it is a scalar quantity. Pick out the only vector quantity in the following list. So we have only impulse. An impulse, in fact, is given by force. Now we can use the cross product into time. And when we have a cross product, since force is a vector quantity, its product with the time, which is in fact a scalar quantity, this gives rise to impulse, which is a vector quantity. State with reasons where the following algebraic expression with scalar and vector physical quantities are meaningful. We'll see all of these. One, this adding a scalar to a vector of the same dimension is not meaningful. You cannot add a scalar with a vector because scalar has only magnitude, and the vector has magnitude as well as the direction, so you cannot add them. Others are meaningful, that is adding scalar with scalar and vector with vector like this. So let us see one by one, adding two scalars. So addition of two scalar is meaningful, but they have to represent same physical quantity. This is very important. Then adding a scalar to a vector of same dimension, as I said, it is not meaningful. You cannot do that. See, multiplying any scalar by any vector by any scalar, yeah, it is meaningful because scalar can be multiplied with a vector. For example, we can multiply force with time in order to obtain impulse. Then the next is multiplying any two scalars. So when we multiply two scalar, yes, it is meaningful because a scalar, which is irrespective of physical quantity it represents, it can be multiplied. Like this is just multiplying 2 into 2 or 2 into 5. It's just like that. It can be multiplied with another scalar having the same or different dimensions. Then we have adding any two vectors. So we can add two vectors, but it is meaningful only when they represent the same physical quantity. Just like this discussion, this has to have same physical quantity. Then a component of a vector can be added to the same vector as they both have the same dimension. This is adding of component of vector to the same vector. So this is also meaningful. A component of a vector can be added to same vector as they both have the same dimensions, because the vector and any of the component, they have the same dimensions. Read each of the statement carefully and state the reason, true or false. So we have two falses here. Let us see one by one. First is the magnitude of a vector is always a vector. The magnitude of a vector is always a vector. So the magnitude of a vector is a number. We know it is a vector, is a number. So it is a scalar. Then each component of a vector is always a scalar. Yes, each component of a vector is also a vector. So that is why each component of a vector is always a scalar. This goes wrong. That is why it is false. As I said, two are false. Then this is true. Next is total path length is a scalar quantity, whereas displacement is a vector quantity. So total path length is always greater than the magnitude of the displacement. It becomes equal to the magnitude of displacement only when the particle is moving in a straight line. See, the total path length is always equal to the magnitude of the displacement vector of a particle. Total path length, or you can say distance, is equal to, always equal to the magnitude of the displacement, right? So in this case, that is why this C is false. Then we have next one. The average speed of a particle defined as total path length divided by the time taken to cover the path is either greater or equal to the magnitude of the average velocity of the particle over the same interval of time. So it is why I said it is true, because the fact that the total path length is always greater than or equal to the magnitude of the displacement of a particle. In fact, total length is the total distance being covered wherever we go. While the displacement is only the distance or the shortest distance or the perpendicular distance between the initial and final position. Next is three vector not lying in a plane can never add up to a given null vector. And this is true, because three vectors which do not lie in a plane, we cannot represent it using a side of triangle or a parallelogram. That is why we cannot have a null vector. Establish the following vector quantity inequalities geometrically or otherwise. So we will use a triangle thing here a lot. And what does the equality sign above apply? Let us start with the first one. See, we have vector A here, we have vector B here. Let us use the parallelogram law. So this is A. So again, this is also A, B, this is B, this is B. So what this will be? ON will be A and this is B. So AB, A plus B, this will be A plus B. So what we can write here is this OM is A, we are taking magnitude, and this MN is B. And when we say ON, which is coming to be A plus B, which is the vector addition. Now in a triangle, each side is smaller than the sum of other two sides. We know that any triangle, you take any two sides, this plus this, it will be always greater than this. This plus this, always greater than this. So this OM plus ON, you take these sides, that is A and B, they will always be greater than A plus B. You can also take the magnitude. But if they are in straight line, means A and B are acting along a straight line in the same direction, we can say that A and B is A plus B. So A plus B is A means if you combine A and B, and if you combine A and B separately, it will be equal. Let us combine these two. This is less than, this is equal to, so this is less than equal to. This is the first one. Now the second one is how to do that. Again, we'll do the same thing. These are two vectors, A and this is B, which are represented by the adjacent side of a parallelogram, which is OMNP. Now we have OM, this OM, which is A, and this MN and also OP is B. What is ON? ON is A plus B, right? This is A plus B. But again, the same thing in a triangle, each side is always smaller than the sum of other two sides. So let us take this triangle OMN again. What we will do here is, we know that this ON plus MN will be greater than OM. Similarly, ON, this ON plus OM will be less than or greater than MN. We'll do use these two. But OP is equal to OP is equal to MN. Why not use OP equal to MN? Let us put it here and take it on this side. So this will be ON, which is greater than OM minus OP. We are just putting this OP here and transferring OM here. That is why this expression has come. Now this is OM is what? A, as you see in the figure. OP is B and AB is A plus B. ON is A plus B. But if these two vectors happen, this A and B happen to act along a straight line in the same direction, we can easily write A plus B is A minus B. This greater than sign changes to equal. This greater than sign is only when this is a triangle, but is equal to when they are in a straight line. Let us combine these two. You get greater than equal to. This is the second one. Now the third one, let two vectors, this A and B, they represent the adjacent side of a parallelogram. But in fact, when we are talking about B, it is like this. So when we are talking about minus B, it has to be in the opposite direction. So this is B, this is minus B. So this is A, this is A, this is minus B. When we add A and minus B, we get A minus B. So here OR, this OR is minus B. This OR is minus B, but the magnitude of OR, which is equal to PS. So magnitude means absolute value. Absolute value means minus x of absolute is x always. So what is being done here? The magnitude or the absolute value is this one. And how about OP? This one OP is A. But in this triangle, we know that each side is smaller than the sum of other two sides. So when we take this triangle OPS, in this OS is always less than OP plus PS. That is, this A minus B, which we just saw in the figure, this A minus B is less than A plus of minus B. But we are taking the modulus, that is the negative sign has to become positive, right? So A minus B is less than equal to A plus B. But when we talk about the two vectors in the straight line in opposite direction, we can just write A minus B is equal to A plus B, because of course the sign is going to change. So this is less than sign, this is equality sign. Combine these two, you get the third one. Next is, let two vectors A and B, this A and B, again we are taking A and B, but we are, it means in the opposite direction, this is minus B. This represents the adjacent side of a parallelogram, which is PQRS, which is shown in the figure. Now, the relation can be written in the form of parallelogram like this. So, OS plus PS is greater than OP. And let us rearrange, OS is greater than OP minus PS. We have just rearranged it. And OS is simply A minus B, OP minus PS is A minus B. Now the quantity on the left hand side is always positive, and that on the RHS can be positive or negative. Why? Because you can have 2 minus 3, you can have 3 minus 2. So it can be positive, negative. So we have to make this quantity always positive. So we have to take the modulus again. We know that this can be 2, this can be 3. So it can be negative. So we have to again take the modulus. So what we are doing here is, we are taking modulus of this, modulus of this, modulus of this. So modulus of modulus is it is same. So we can write these two as one, these two as one. But in this case, we have to have a modulus here, and after that we have to have a modulus here. But this is first situation. But if the two vectors are in the straight line but in opposite direction, we can easily write A minus B is equal to the modulus A minus modulus B. This is equality sign. This is greater than sign. Combine these two, you get this one, which is the final one. We are given A plus B plus C plus D equal to 0. Which of the following statements are correct? First is A, B, C, D must each be a null vector. See, it is incorrect. Why? If this has to be 0, it is not necessary that all the four given vectors to be null vector. There are various other combinations which can make this as 0. So this statement is incorrect. Next is your A plus B plus C plus D, or you can say the magnitude of A plus C equals to magnitude of BD. So let us take AB here and transfer CD on this side. It becomes minus. Let us take modulus here. This negative sign goes, so A plus C becomes equal to B plus D modulus. So the magnitude of A plus C is equal to magnitude of B plus D is correct. Next is the magnitude of A can never be greater than the sum of magnitude of B, C, D. So what it shows is, let us take A here and B, C, D on the other side. So A, take modulus, so modulus of A gives modulus of B plus C plus D. And in fact, if you take modulus of one by one, it is less than equal to, which shows that the magnitude of A is equal or less than the sum of the magnitude of BCD. So the magnitude of A can never be greater than the sum of the magnitudes of B, C and D. Next one is B plus C must lie in the plane of A and D. If A and D are not collinear and in the line of A and D, if they are collinear. What collinearity means? It has to be on the same line. Non-collinear means they are not in the same line. So the resultant sum of A, B, C and D, when it can be zero? They can be zero only if B plus C lie in the same plane of A and D. We can assume that these three vectors are represented by three sides of a triangle. But when we are talking about triangle, if A and D are collinear, what it implies? It implies that the vector B plus C is in the same line of A and D. So this holds only when this vector sum of all the vectors will be zero. Three girls skating on a circular ice ground of radius 200 meter. So this has radius 200 meter. What will be the diameter? It will be 400 meter. Just multiply it by 2. From a starting point P, from here it starts on the edge of the ground and it reaches Q diametrically opposite to P. And there are three paths. This one and this one. Means first is taking this path, second is taking the shortest path, third is taking this path. What is the magnitude of the displacement vector for each? The magnitude, the displacement will be same because displacement is only the shortest distance between the initial position and the final position, that is between P and Q. So wherever you go like this also. It will be, if you come back here, this will be PQ. So the displacement vector is like this. And for which girl is this equal to the actual length of the path skated? It is B. She has started from P, ended at Q with the straight line. So displacement is given by the minimum distance between the initial position and final position. And here we have P and Q are the initial final position. Radius is 200, so diameter is 400. So the magnitude of the displacement of each girl will be simply 400 meters, and which is equal to the actual length of the path being skated by girl B. A cyclist starts from the center O, he starts from here, of a circle park of radius 1 kilometer, reaches the edge and then cycles around the circumference and returns to the center, right? If the round trip takes 10 minutes, what is the net displacement, average velocity and average speed of the cyclist? Now this is radius, so it will be R plus R. What is this? Total is 2 pi r. So this will be 2 pi r by 4. This is 1/4. So 2 pi r by 4. Radius is 1. And this is 2 pi into 1 by 4. So this will be the total distance. What is the net displacement? He starts from here. He comes again back to the same position. So the displacement will be 0. Now I'll find the average velocity. Average velocity will be 0 because the displacement is 0. How about the average speed? Average speed will be what? Average speed will be this distance divided by 10 minutes because this is the time taken. So let us see one by one. Displacement is given by the minimum distance between initial and final position. In this case, the cyclist is coming back to its original position in 10 minutes, but the net displacement is 0 because the initial and final position are equal. The average velocity is given by what? Net displacement by total time. So again, the net displacement of a cyclist is 0. So average velocity will be 0. The average speed of the cyclist is given by what? Average speed is simply total path length by total time. As I said, R plus R plus this distance. This distance is 2 pi r by 4. This is 1/4 of a circumference. So when we combine them, you get this. But 10 minutes has to be changed to the hour. So 10 by 60 divided by 60, you get 1 by 6. Now divide this by this. This is average speed. Distance by time, you get this value. On an open ground, a motorist follows a track that turns to his left by an angle of 60 degree after every 500 meter. Starting from a given turn, specify the displacement of the motorist at the third, sixth, eighth turn. Compare the magnitude of the displacement of the total path length covered by the motorist in each case. So what is happening? He is starting from P. Then after traveling or moving for 500 meter, by 60 degree, he changes its position. And this goes again and again. Third, sixth and eighth. So one, this is the first term, this is the second term, this is the third term. So this is the third term. Then fourth, fifth, sixth, this is the sixth term. Seventh, eighth, this is the eighth term. So we have to find out the displacement. And this is quite easy because why? This is 500, this is 500. So distance can easily be computed. And what will be the displacement? If let us take this position. Displacement is this one. Since it is a regular hexagon, this will also be 500 meter. Let me tell you. First is magnitude of displacement, which is Ps here. Ps. As I said, this is 500, this is 500. It will be 500 plus 500. Total path length is this plus this plus this plus will have 3 only. So 500 plus 500 plus 500, which gives you 1500 meter. Then the motorist take the sixth turn at where? At point P, as I told you earlier. This is the point P. This is sixth. So what will be the distance? 500, 500, 500, 500, 500, 500. This many times. So this will be 3000 meter. What is the displacement? He started from P. He came back again to P. That means the displacement is zero. Now the motorist take 8 turn at R. This one. What will be the magnitude of the displacement? The displacement will be what? Simply PR. And how to find PR? We will use the cosine law. This is the angle. See, we have angle, this angle. So this angle can be used easily. Okay. So this is P. This is P Q square, this square plus QR square plus 2 into PR into QR cos 60 degree. This directly we have to use, you know, the other thing I'll tell you just now. But this is a cosine formula to know. If you don't know, then you have to learn this, or you have to learn it by heart. This is the value. We have just put all the values. This is 500, 500, 500, 500. Cos 60 is half. Now, how to find this beta? How to find this beta? There are various methods. This is the direct formula, you know. It is given in the textbook. So, you can always go with the direct formula. But I'll just tell you in short. Okay. I dropped a perpendicular. Now, what will be the beta? Beta will be tan. Tan beta will be perpendicular by base. Perpendicular is, let me take it as O. This will be RO by this PO. But what is PO? PQ plus QO. PO is PQ plus QO. So RO is what? See, RO. This is beta. So it will be PR sine theta, sine component. And what will be QO? This will be, or what will be this hole? This will be 500 plus QR cos theta, right? So that is why 500 sine theta plus 500 cos theta, and this will be, tan inverse will be, of this angle will be 30 degree. So the magnitude of displacement is this, angle is 30 degree with PR. Total path length is circumference of hexagon, means total you have to cover. Then again, you have to cover this and this. So total is 6 into 500, then 500, then 500. So for this position, we have 400 meter as the total distance. In all, whatever we have seen is given in this table. A passenger arriving in a new town wishes to go from station to a hotel located 10 km away on a straight line from the station. So it is given in the question that the station and the place he wants to go, if you take draw a straight line or a perpendicular line, then it is 10 km apart. The dishonest man or dishonest cabman takes him along a circuitous, means he took like this, and this distance is 23 km. And he reaches the hotel at 28 minutes. He might have taken this path 10 km, he might have reached in shorter time. But the question is being asked is, what is the average speed of the taxi, the magnitude of average velocity, and are the two equal? So this question is very straightforward because the total distance given is 23 km and the total time is 28 minutes. 28 minutes is what? 28 minutes divided by 60 to get it in hour. 28 by 60. What will be the average speed? Average speed will be total distance by total time. So divide these two, you get 49 by 29. Now the distance between hotel, we are going for the second one. So distance between the hotel and station, the shortest distance is 10 km. and the time taken is 28 minutes. This is 28 minutes. So let us divide now the 10 km with 28 by 60. This will be average velocity. In average velocity, we always have to take the displacement. In average speed, we have to take the total path length, the total distance traveled. Here we have taken 10 because it is the shortest distance. This is the displacement. When you divide these two, you get this. So the two physical quantities, that is namely average speed and average velocity, they are not equal. Rain is falling vertically with a speed of 30 meter per second. A woman rides a bicycle with a speed of 10 meter per second in the north-south direction. What is the direction in which she should hold her umbrella? So the situation here is the rain is vertically falling. So this north-south is like, see, you might confuse yourself north-south, east-west. This is not like this. This is simply the north-south direction, but the rain is falling from the upwards, means from the sky. So therefore, this diagram is being made. So the situation is like this. We'll take this VC as the velocity of the cyclist, VR as the velocity of the falling rain. Okay. So since this, let me show you here. We want to protect, or the cyclist would like to protect from the rain. So the woman must hold umbrella in the direction of the relative velocity of the rain. And what will be the relative velocity? This is VC. This is minus VC. And because this is the direction of the cyclist and this is the direction of the rain, so the resulting will be, with the parallelogram law, the resulting velocity will be like this. So what it will be? VR plus of minus VC, that is VR plus of minus VC. That is VR minus VC essentially, which is 20 meter per second, which is given as 30 and 10. What will be 10 theta? It will be simply this divided by this. That means this is VC divided by VR. 10 by 30, take 10 inverse 1 by 3, which is going to give you 18 degree. So the woman must hold the umbrella towards, and what is the direction of this? Towards the south at an angle of 18 degree. 18 degree with the vertical. So she has to hold like this. So it has to be towards south. A man can swim with a speed of 4 km in still water. How long does he take to cross a river 1 km wide? If the river flows steadily at 3 km per hour and he makes strokes normal to the river current, how far does the river does he go when he reaches the other bank? Now, so scenario is something like this. If water wouldn't have been there, I'm taking imagination, it is not possible still. The person would have gone like this, but there is a current. So there is water, this is a current. So by the drift of this current, he will reach here while he is swimming. So he is swimming with a speed of 4. That is, he is swimming in this direction with 4 in still water. How long, and the distance from here to here is 1 kilometer. Now, if the river flows steadily at 3 km per hour, so the direction of river is this, which is 3 km per hour. This is 4 km per hour. And he makes normal stroke. How far does the river, how far down the river goes, or river does he go when he reaches the bank? So because of the drift, he will not reach like this. He will reach somewhere here. Okay, so we have to find this. Let us see. First is the speed of man is 4 km per hour. Width is given as 1 km. So what is the time taken to cross the river? Simply the distance by speed. Distance is 1 kilometer. Speed is 4 kilometer. So 1 by 4. 1 by 4 hour. Let us change it into minutes. So it will be 1 by 4 into 60. That is 15 minutes. Now what is the speed of the river? What is the speed of the river? The speed of river is 3. But the speed of the river in this particular time will be what? Because the river might have reached here somewhere in this time. So speed of river is 3 and the time is 15 minutes. So multiply it by 1 by 4. Well, you can take 1 by 4, you can take 15 minutes. So 3 into 1 by 4, it will be 3 by 4 kilometer. 1 kilometer is 1000 meter. So just multiply these two, 3 by 4 into 1000, you get 750 meter. And this 750 meter is the distance, or this far down river he will go when he reaches the other bank. In a harbor, wind is blowing at the speed of 72 km an hour. So there is a harbor, a ship is there, or a boat is there. A flag has the mast of a boat. A flag on the mast. So in the front part of the boat, there is a flag. And we always know that the flag will flow only in the direction of the wind. So the flag on the mast of a boat anchored in the harbor flutters along northeast direction. So we know that the wind is at northeast direction. If the boat starts moving at speed 51 km an hour to the north, what is the direction of the flag on the mast of the boat? So this is the scenario here. Please understand that velocity of the boat, this VB is given 51 km per hour. This is the VW, which is this one, northeast direction. And since we have to take this minus VB, because B, which we have taken as boat, the boat is having a speed of 51 km per hour to the north. So this is VB. Okay, it is going like this. Now, the flag is fluttering in northeast direction, which is given by this line. This shows that the wind is blowing towards the northeast direction. So, when the ship begins sailing towards the north, the flag will move along the direction of the relative velocity, which is given by what? This, and we have minus VB. So, this is the direction of the, this is the relative velocity of the flag on the mast. So this is the relative velocity, and we know that the angle between VW and VB is what? Which we are talking about, this one. What is this whole angle? From here to here it is 90 degree. From this point to this point it is 45 degree. How? See, if you say northeast, from here to here it is 90 degree. Here to here is 45 degree. 90 plus 45, that is 135 degree. So the angle between these two, VB and minus VW and minus VB, is this one, 135. And we have known that this formula, we can use 10 beta, will be simply this 51, as I showed you in the previous questions also, that this will be 51 sine 90 plus 45 by 72 plus 51 cos 90 plus 45. These are 135 degree. Just solve it, you get the angle as 41.11 degree. But we are talking, the angle with respect to each direction is what? This hole is coming 45 degree, and this hole is 45 degree, and this total is 45.11. So the angle with respect to each direction is simply 45.11 minus 45. So the flag will flutter almost due east. A ceiling of a long hall is 25 meter high. What is the maximum horizontal distance that a ball thrown with a speed of 40 meter per second can go without hitting the ceiling of the hall? So this is the scenario, this is the height, it has to go like this without hitting. So it's a projectile motion. The speed of the ball is given u as 40 meter per second. Maximum height is also given as 25 meter. So in a projectile motion, we know the maximum height reached by a body thrown at an angle theta is given like this, h equal to u square sine square theta by 2g. H is given 25, u is 40. We have to find sine theta, so the theta basically. So all these values are given, g we have taken as 9.8. So sine theta will be equal to this much degree. Now, the second scenario is u square sine 2 theta by g, and which is what? It is the horizontal distance. So you can call it as a range. U square is 40 square sine 2 theta. Theta we will use as 33.60 here. And we'll put all value, we get 150.53 meter. So this is the first part of the discussion we have in motion in a plane. We'll take one more. Till then, thank you so much. Take care of yourself.